flex drive.
Yeah. What then one is fit with the flex drive sound?
There's very little known about the sort of fundamental genetics of impulse tracking that would work.
That's right.
There have been one or two articles in journals like Scientific American, but it's still not much understood about.
Yeah, you talked about this zebras on the 50-50.
Yeah, I have seen that program, but I don't know. It was some time back.
It was a long time ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
And each lane is an individual animal. And it's an excellent measure. I mean, just looking at it, you can see that shows diversity, that shows non-diversity, if you like, lack of diversity. So it's a very powerful, useful method. We're using that a lot nowadays. Very new methods, they've come out in the last few years. They're called microsatellites. You might even have heard the word.
I know.
It's one of the trendiest new techniques in molecular genetics.
Like the most common variety is now getting interbred with like domestic cats.
Well, that's exactly what this study is in fact for. What we're trying to do is to show how interbred domestic cat is with wild cats. And rather nicely, it looks like in fact it's, but it's the same story as this. Effectively, we're finding alleles in wild cat, which are rather like this, only found in wild cat, not found in domestic cat.
Allele is spelled A-L-L,
or it tends to be a lot of variation. What happens is, in fact, we're looking at the repeat unit, in fact. It's a pair of bases which are repeated. When DNA multiplies, it's not very good at multiplying stretches like that correctly, and it's solving, being, of course, an immense forensic value to these forensics.
Right.
Looking for murders, rape cases, those sort of things, using sexy, not very effectively. Doesn't get a virtually 100% answer. Civil case coming up, we're quite sure they... If he was cross because his technique could be questioned. So he got himself back.
But his technique's not the best one,
isn't it? It wasn't quite, it's an orthologous DNA thing, which is a bit more difficult than this, is what we call single office test, because you can get... Despite the fact he's got off there, he doesn't get research, he's got much of a life now, so I think everybody could eat him. I think everybody shunned him, I think, in that
case. Well, I know in the States, the majority of black people quite resentment, and the majority of white people are going to go to.
Well, it's a good way of getting back at the authorities.
I think so, unfortunately, too long, so don't make it
right. No, they don't, but it's understandable. Anyway, it didn't get off the talking.
I mean,
it's like,
I suppose
it's paid
the penalty,
but it was
supposed to.
Well, that's charisma. What sort of program are you going to think you're using on this?
Well, I'm sort of everything. Because he says to me, the first term is work session. We told the first term is work is the most important one.
No, really, no, it's across the board.
That's what I thought.
Across the board.
It's just the basics.
The first terms were definitely important, yes, but they can't forget the rest either.
Yeah.
And they've got to know their stuff.
Yeah, so okay, and I was pretty off because now he's not here and Pete's not here either. The time for them, so. Yeah. Okay.
But they're examining the time for them.
Yeah.
Sorry,
yes,
students
worrying
about
it. And I have young
Alzheimer's
in my
room,
so I can't recall anything.
We're talking about... So, are you normally based in Britain, then?
No,
I'm
based in New York.
Based in New York? So that's your hometown, is it?
Mm-hmm. That's your accent.
It's a wonderful
place. Because you have both of them, you have the sea, you have the hills. I was also in the one country. Ah, it's gorgeous, man.
Yes, I mean, we have the central line here, it's about 5 minutes to my back door.
Mm.
better.
Hello.
They usually come out late evening. We got a couple of steenbok a day and so on and so on. Now we don't have predators on site, except for humans. And the biggest predator we got from the bush is a meerkat. It's a little
meerkat. Oh, yes.
They pinch eggs and young birds and so on. And because we got two dams on site, all our water ends up, all the water consumed on site for whatever reason, ends up in the dam. Either this via the sewage pond or directly via settling pond, water that comes from the labs, etc. Now that water we use for irrigation. So all the water on site is at least used once or twice. Now, because of the dam and the little island I made in the dam, we attract birds. We got a count of about 85 so far. Then the environmental club, in order to keep it separate from our non-scientific expenses, because obviously this place runs on government grants, so some people might question and say, you know, why would you have animals in a scientific setting? So we made an internal, voluntary environmental club where people pay every month a bit. And that goes in a kitty, and that money is used to keep up the animals, etc., etc. We bought a couple of swans for the dam. For the rest, we tried to keep it as indigenous as possible. Now, the quaggas is, or the zebras is something totally different in the sense that they don't belong to us, they do belong to the Quagga project, of which Rao has been, because those people have also no money, it's only by donations and grants. So the input cost is minimal, and they are safe and secure here. So we provide the site for them, we got five for the moment, and they got no different sites, but that you all know from Rao. All the Frolicate Reserve, which is in McGregor, which is next to Robertson. That's about two, 3 hours drive from here. But through the years, because they were kept in camps, which makes it easier to interchange and lead them from one to the other. But that meant they had to be fed. They had no shelter, and they had to be fed, and that became a bit costly. Right. So Cape Nature Conservation, they got fed up with it. And they asked them to remove, and that's when they started looking around for possible sites in charge of all the animals on site, except the zebras who belong to the Quagga project. So we only provide the site. And as they produce, they keep the animals, the smaller animals, which fit into the progress system, so that if you've seen the little figurine they made, that's what they, and it's getting there slowly. See all the stripes are getting less. That's a good example. No, we got an open window. Of all the individual animals. one as the son. That's the original mother, if you might call her.
Quite a nice example of a heavy stripe. Get on the road.
Sorry?
Stay out. Go ahead.
Better stopping. Off the engine. Just wait till they might walk right up to us. Thank you.
have a look at the baby.
Got it. Clap your hands or whatever. Are you what?
Going to be.
Eh?
Yep.
Run at them! Thank you.
them, though it is difficult, but at the same time, if one can go to the rural areas where you find that one doctor is waiting for about 1,000 patients, or maybe 500 patients, some of them look good.
I think as long as it's incentives driven, you know, because doctors also have to make a living at the end of the day.
Yes, I do understand. But at the same time, if they don't want to do that, I'm not saying that it is a good concept, but at the same time, it's the issue of people need to negotiate. The government at the same time said they do try to deliver, because I'm seeing this issue. Some people think that never since 1994 there's no change. I'm seeing to go to such people that are lying.
Where are you calling us from? Brakpan?
Yes.
Tell us about the visible changes around Brakpan.
Okay, particularly in the area of material pairing of roads, and then the issue of there was some changes, as well as on the issue of a school web of a feeding scheme, whereby I cannot say that if I don't benefit, but the next person benefiting, there's no change. That seems to be a problem. I think that when other people do benefit, then I don't benefit, then I seem to say that no, there's no change. That is not fair. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, thanks for your contributions. Thanks for 089-31-033-77. Give us a call. We have our open line and it's water with the compliments of Telcom. We'll move on to
the Yeah, this is a proper zebra.
Mm.
Birchall's Plains zebra.
You better say Plains.
Plains zebra.
I thought that was the form from the program.
Yeah.
So it's really not best example because it's got quagga characteristics.
Well, it has, one can't say quagga characteristics, but it is approaching it more than these here because the legs are already partly unstriped. And it got a nice brownish tint that you will not find in Kenya or north of the Zambezi anywhere. There they're really black and white and fully striped to the hooves, like this animal is. Now you're looking at a mountain zebra.
Yeah, I'll do that on the D30.
The next pole is completely striped. You might want to take a little of that as well.
Mm-hmm.
You got from this to the fully striped fold. And there's a fourth fold coming now.
Mm.
The skin you will see much better exhibit of this.
Mm.
So stuck away here. Maybe one day that will be done.
Mm. I bought one of the quagga T-tails.
Sorry?
I got a quagga
T-tail. T-shirt?
T-tail.
Oh, T-tail. Mm-hmm. Have they got this down here now? I know they were busy getting a few things. They always come and show me what they want to do, especially the text. And also the illustration, the artist first had stripes on the buttock which had to be taken off and so on. I must go and see what they all got. They're going to have a whole lot of things.
Mm.
Always go by.
The stripes on a zebra's rump compared with the ones that are now.
Yeah, but you say the zebra, there are different zebras.
Yes.
This is a mountain zebra.
Mountain and
that has nothing to do with the quagga. The rest here are plain zebras. They are the quagga's cousins. This is a distant cousin.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different species, this.
Yes.
You see, in this animal, the body stripes go right around onto the belly.
these ones end.
This is.
Thank you.
15,000 rand.
What?
That's an unbelievable thing.
Okay. Oh, the video. Mm.
And it records it onto a video cassette, a small little video cassette.
Oh.
Unbelievable. 15,000.
And you can see what you want. What you do.
Thank you.
The Quagga project began about 1984, shortly after Reinhold had sent a little piece of skin over to the United States, where an enterprising biochemist called Russell Higuchi in Alan Wilson's lab in Berkeley, California, extracted some DNA from the specimen and was able to show that the DNA showed that the quagga was in fact the same species of animal as the plain zebra, a common animal in the southern African subcontinent. And as a consequence, it meant that the striping patterns which characterized the quagga and which had resulted in the quagga effectively disappearing when it was all shot out about over a century ago, might still in fact be still found, or the genes characterizing these color patterns might be found in the living, currently living populations in plain zebra that were found, those populations that were nearest to where the quagga originally lived. And as a consequence of this, it meant that a selective breeding program might be able to be done using those animals amongst the current population which were least striped relative to the others, because it was known that there's quite a lot of variation in the striping patterns of the plain zebra. So by choosing those which showed the least marked striping patterns, it might be by selective breeding we could get an animal back in about three or four generations, which was a good approximation to the original quagga. It began way back about 1986, just after Reinhold from the South African Museum had sent across to the States a small piece of tissue from one of the last of the quaggas. And this was used in the United States for studies on DNA. And the DNA studies were enabled us to say that in fact the quagga was the same species as the current population of plain zebra or virtual zebra, which is widespread on the southern African continent. And this was an important finding because it meant that since the animal was the same species, and also given that the color patterns which we see in the current population of plain zebra is very variable, that it might be possible to retrieve the color patternings of the quagga by a selective breeding program.
Can you stop there? Sorry. Just do
what? About the right length, or a bit shorter?
It's a bit shorter.
I'll try.
Okay.
Thank you.
So how did the quagga project begin?
The quagga project began about 8 years ago now, when Reinhold from the South African Museum sent across a small piece of tissue to a laboratory in the United States where they performed DNA studies. Now these DNA studies were interesting because they proved that the quagga was the same species as the plain zebra, which is widespread on the southern African continent. And given that fact, and the additional fact that we knew there's a lot of variation in the color patterns in the plain zebra, it seemed plausible, therefore, that we might be able to retrieve the quagga, or at least its color patterns back, by a selective breeding program. If the program succeeds, then effectively we can show that it isn't extinct, at least to the extent that the genes which give rise to these color patterns, the genes for color striping and the brown color that characterize the quagga, that they're not extinct, that they're simply diluted out, if you like, into the current living populations of the plain zebra. In that sense, it wouldn't be extinct.
Have you brought an animal back from extinction?
Hang on.
We're getting it. That will remain to be seen. If I
shall
we start that again?
Are
quagga extinct? Well, this depends, I think, on the success or otherwise of the breeding program. If it's successful, then it will mean that, in a technical sense, at least the quagga is not extinct. That the genes characterizing it haven't been lost completely, they've been diluted out into the current population of the plain zebra, in the same way as if you bred a Siamese cat with a lot of ordinary cats, you'd no longer see the Siamese cat pattern, but you might be able to get it back again by a similar type of selective breeding.
And how will you know whether the project's been
How does the breeding program work? The way we're doing it is to select animals from the current population of plains zebu, which have very reduced, the most reducing striping patterns which we can find, breed them together, and then look at their offspring. We'd expect that some offspring would be more striped than the parents, some the same, and some less striped. The more striped offspring we'd sell off to other people who'd like to buy zebra, thereby enriching the population which we have in our breeding program, which are less striped. And in that way, over the course of 3 or 4 generations, hopefully, we'll develop the degree of reduction of striping to an extent where we can claim, perhaps, to have a quagga. What is a quagga?
Can you not repeat the question, but just use the question like a quagga is, okay?
Got it.
Okay.
Okay, say again.
What is a quagga?
A quagga is a plain zebra, effectively, which has a particular color pattern, the main features of which are reduction in striping over the rear half of the body and the back legs, together with a rich dark brown color to the skin, or to the pelage, the fur, giving an animal which looks sort of almost horse-like from the shoulders downwards, but still definitely zebra-like and striped from the shoulders upwards. There's some criticism that if we did get an animal back, then all we'd have would be a quagga look-alike, and it wouldn't really be a quagga. There's some point to that question, because we don't know all the characteristics which defined the original quagga, but on the other hand, the only thing we have to go on is the old photographs and the stuffed skins found in museums, and all they really show us is the color of the fur and the striping patterns. So I would say that if we get those characteristics back in our selective breeding program, then we've got a quagga in terms at least of how the quagga was originally defined.
And this is not an easy process at all, to try and retrieve an animal that's
lived in a box. Well, it may be a fairly easy process in terms of the fact that it's a simple selective breeding program. It is, of course, unique in the sense that we're not trying to create anything new or to get back an extinct species. Half the point of the project is to show that, in fact, if we can do it, then it will mean that the animal wasn't extinct. The genes would simply be diluted out into the populations of zebra surrounding where the quagga originally, where its locality originally was. And in that sense, what we'll have done is reconcentrated those genes that describe the quagga, and therefore we would have the quagga back again. But it would not be regenerating an extinct species. We're not trying to do that at all. Say something to that effect.
Yes.
It may be that one must be careful how you use the word extinct. If a species goes extinct, then that effectively is forever. There's no way you can get it back again. So, in our case, the DNA studies seem to show that the quagga is not extinct. At least it's a plain zebra, and the plain zebra is certainly still living. It's simply the genes showing this particular color variant have been lost to the extent that they're lost probably into the current populations of the plain zebra. So in that respect, if we get the quagga back, we won't have saved an animal from extinction, but we will have shown at least that the quagga is in a way still living, simply diluted out into a form we can't see. We have the quaggas distributed over about 4 or 5 different localities, and they're chosen for 2 reasons. One, they need to have adequate feeding, basically means enough grass to eat off the ground, because that means we don't have to pay a lot of money to feed them. The other reason is to have them fairly close to the main center of where the project is, which is basically in Cape Town and Stellenbosch. But the main purpose is for the feeding purposes, to make sure they've got adequate fodder. And we've also chosen sites where the local people who own the ground are happy to have them there. I think it's very interesting to see the change in a species that can occur with selective breeding, particularly in this unique case where we're doing the reverse of, say, the usual thing, where you might want to select a particularly interesting color variety of a cat, for example. That would be breeding for something new. Here, we're doing the reverse. We're trying to get back to something which existed before. Again, just as if we were trying with crossbred cats to see if we could get a Siamese pattern back or something like that. There'd be no point of that, of course, but here we're trying to get back a naturally occurring pattern, colour pattern, which was widespread and well known at a particular period of historical time. No, I think effectively it can't. That's why it's unique and why it's so important to have proven that, in fact, that the quagga was a plain zebra. You couldn't do it with another animal like a blueback that went extinct because there are no living relatives close enough to be able to find the genes in those populations to be able to do a selective breeding program like this. So, no, it's unique. Yes, how do you match up the DNA? This is done by sequencing a small piece of the DNA, and it's like a few lines of print in a textbook. If the lines of text, if you like, that analogy from the quagga are identical to those which you get from a plain zebra, then you can say they're the same species with a very high degree of certainty. If they're significantly different, then you can say this amount of difference is more typical of what we find between different species, like between a horse and a zebra, or even more different, like between a horse and a man, for example. So we can quantitate the amount of difference by these means.
So what exactly did DNA analysis show in this case?
It showed from about 200...
Again, the DNA
from the analysis showed from about 200 base pairs of sequences, we call it, 200 letters of the code, if you like, that the two sequences were effectively identical between the quagga and the zebra, having allowed for one or two post-mortem changes which occurred since the DNA that was used was about 180 years old.
And what you can't find, though, is the genetic material of the DNA that controls the colour and structure. So might there be other variations?
If we had looked at a great deal more DNA, then undoubtedly we find the odd difference here and there, because even two individual humans will differ in about one in every 200 base pairs, or letters, if you like, in the code. So what we're looking for is an amount of change no more than that. And that, in fact, is exactly what was found.
Ultimately, what is the long-term aim of the project?
The long-term aim will be that if we're successful in getting a small herd of animals which look sufficiently like the quagga for us to make our claim to start again.
I'll ask the question again, and I can probably do that a bit better.
Well, the long-term aim is to try and establish a small herd of quaggas, or at least animals which look like the quagga, which we will claim are quaggas by the reasons I've stated, and to introduce these into one of the national parks in the vicinity where the quagga originally occurred, that is in the region of the Western Cape. And then we'll have a herd of animals which will remind people of what this animal was and what it looked like, retrieved and restored to its original locality.
Is there anything I haven't asked that becomes important?
And so how do I feel about it personally? I think the sort of the personal enjoyment, if you like, if I can use that word of a project like this, is the first of all the scientific interest of seeing if a selective program really will reduce the sliping patterns right back so that we can get an animal looking like the original, but also the individual enjoyment of going out into the field, looking at the animals, looking at the new foals of the born, and seeing whether they are indeed conforming to the genetics which we think they'll follow, some more striped, some less striped, and then to choose those which are less striped, breed them over the course of the years with other ones in the group, and see how they develop.
What do you think of the new foal ones here in the way you sort of... How did you feel coming out to see the new foal
that's been born here? Well, it's always a delight, isn't it, coming out and seeing a new member of the family, so to speak, particularly this, which is a delightful little animal, and also has very nice colour patterns. So again, you can see it starting to approach a quagga, a halfway stage, if you like, towards a quagga.
What do you do with foals that don't appropriate the right colour patterns?
They'll be sold off to...
you have to explain foals that don't have...
With foals which don't show an appropriate colour pattern, or who are more striped than their parents, they are, in fact, quite useful because we sell those off to other farmers or individuals who are establishing herds of zebra for just a general tourist attraction and other breeding programs of zebras. And, of course, they bring a little money into the project.
And how did quaggas get
here? Yes, and I'm glad you call them quagga instead of the name quagga, which is, of course, how the English tend to say it. The quagga is the correct term, and the guttural, in fact, helps to show that the name derived from an attempt to reproduce the sound which a quagga makes, which is a sort of broad bark, quagga. And hence its name is simply a description of the sound the quagga makes.
And how did the quagga become eradicated? What happened?
That was when the Europeans first... How did the quagga... Okay, let me start again. The quagga was originally eliminated from the Western Cape, where it occurred in huge numbers some hundreds of years ago, when the Western settlers first arrived here with their guns, and of course in those days you shot everything on sight, and they effectively managed to wipe out almost the entire herd of quaggas, which ran into hundreds of thousands in those days. A sad story. Of exploitation and the rap.
Yeah. Okay.
Actually, if you pick up that air conditioning.
This is Buzz Track or the Quagga interview.
Can they subtract the background noise in some extent if they do it? Thank you.
Now, this quagga foal is one of the 23 preserved ones worldwide. This museum obtained it in 1858. It was actually obtained as a live foal. We don't know how, but probably the mother was shot. They caught the foal, they tried to keep it alive, but that wasn't successful. After a few days it died, and then it was skinned, and so the museum received it. It is the only one left on the African continent. The other 22 are all in European museums. There are a few skeletons and loose skulls, which are probably outside Europe. That the quagga became extinct was really an accident. And I think one of the main reasons, obviously all big game in the quagga's distribution area, being the Karoo and the Southern Orange Free State, they have been quite ruthlessly hunted because they were seen as grazing competitors to the farmers' livestock. But if it had been realized that the quagga was near extinction, I believe efforts would have been made to save it, as efforts were made to save the Cape Mountain zebra, which was once very close to extinction. And also considering that the bontebok was already given legal protection in the 1800s,